Welcome. I'm Liz Taylor, ocean explorer, naturalist, and entrepreneur.
I'm Sylvia Earle. I'm an oceanographer. I am an explorer with National Geographic, founder of Mission Blue, and I'm an ocean elder. Thank you, ocean elders, for sponsoring this program.
And this is our show, Dive In, where we host informal and open conversations with the ocean community on topics of wonder and interest. We're so glad to be back and hope everyone has made some time to be outdoors in between the storms here. It's been pretty rough. We're excited today to be diving in with Luiz Rocha and talking last time about butterfly fish, but this time talking about amazing parrotfish, some of our favorites. And as we go through the conversation today, please put your questions into the Q&A box. And we'll get through as many as we can. And before we jump in, Luiz is going to share the slides today. Before we dive in, we're going to remind everyone that the world
is blue. Never forget. Oh, the fish don't forget.
The fish don't forget.
No.
Great to see you again, Luiz.
Good to see you. Thanks for having me again. Always a pleasure.
Yeah. You're just back from the Maldives?
Maldives, yes.
Beautiful.
Yeah.
Parrotfish there that are kind of special.
Lots and lots of parrotfish there, yes.
They're special wherever they occur.
They are. I so love these fish. They're just incredibly beautiful to look at, and they just you know, most people know what a parrot looks like, but what about a parrotfish?
Right. Yeah, and they perform amazing ecological roles in the ecosystem. They're ecosystem engineers, so they're really important and really colorful, really good-looking, interesting fish.
They're gorgeous.
Part of what makes a coral reef a coral reef. You know, coral reefs are not just about the structures of the living coral. It takes a whole system. And I look forward to hearing your thoughts about what would a coral reef be without the parrotfish?
It would be a very, very sad place. Do you see my screen?
We do.
Okay. So I'll start by talking a little bit about the color in that fish there, and in a lot of parrotfish and in a lot of reef fish. And this is a question that goes back to what you talked about, Sylvia, about coral reefs, is the diversity in shapes and colors. And a lot of people ask me, why are coral reef fish so colorful? And if you look at a coral reef, without the fish in it, it is already a very colorful ecosystem. So being colorful helps them blend into the ecosystem, if you will.
Oh, yeah.
They don't need to be cryptic. The more colorful they are, the more blended with the background they are. So that's one of the reasons why coral reef fish are so colorful, and parrotfish are so colorful in particular.
They blend right in.
They blend right into the very colorful background ecosystem. So this photo here, like I started with the butterfly fish a few months ago, this photo here is one of the first photos I took underwater, again, with a film camera. So you can kind of see the grain there in the photo. Mm-hmm. And again, one of the species that I am more familiar with because I grew up with it in Brazil. So this is a species that is only in Brazil, Sparizoma amplum. It's quite similar to a species in the Caribbean, Sparizoma viride, the stoplight parrotfish, so you might have seen that, except for the Caribbean one has a yellow tail, yellow band on the tail there, and the Brazilian one has a red band. There's a few other differences, but the most obvious one is that one. And this kind of highlights some of the work that some of my colleagues and I did in Brazil, which was looking at the genetics of those species, Brazil versus Caribbean. So there's a lot of species in Brazil that look a lot like the species in the Caribbean. And the differences are mostly in color. And back in I don't know, 30 or 40 years ago, when genetics was not a thing, everybody assumed those species were the same. Because if you look at them after they're preserved in formalin, and then alcohol, they lose all their colors. So they're just brown fish, and you can't see the yellow tail and the red tail. So we only started noticing those differences when we started doing underwater photography, and we could only confirm the differences when we started doing genetics. And this species used to be one species. It used to be treated as Sparizoma viride, the same as in the Caribbean, But after we did photography work and we kind of honed in more in the color differences, and we did some genetics work, we determined that it was different genetically from the Caribbean one also.
It's a really great shot. I can see, like, it looks like some little cleaner wrasse and things in the picture too.
Right, right.
Around there.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
Oh, these guys.
Yes. So this is just a variety of parrotfishes from the Indo-Pacific. Most of these photos I took in Bali, one of them there in the Marshall Islands. But again, to show you how diverse the whole group is. And I don't know about you, but if you compare this one to that slide that I showed with all the different types of butterfly fish, to me, butterfly fish are a lot easier to tell apart than parrotfish, because most of them are like different shades of blue and green. Very rare you find other colors than blue and green and yellow and a little bit of red here and there, not much red, although there are exceptions. So I'll come back to exceptions the whole talk here. And that's a lot about what biology is about. Every time you come up with a rule in biology, there's an exception, right? So in parrotfish is the same, can be different.
We all like to break the rules a little bit now and then,
exactly.
Right?
Exactly. In biology is notorious for that. You come up with a rule and then you come up, well, almost immediately you come up with a bunch of exceptions. The other interesting thing about parrotfishes too is that they're a lot harder to photograph, at least to me, than butterfly fish. Butterfly fish are the right size fish for you to get close enough to, and then still have a lot of strobe light on them. Parrotfish, because they're bigger in general, I think most of those fish there in the photos are 10, 20, maybe 30 inches long. You have to be far away from them to be able to photograph. And when you're far away from your subject underwater, less light reaches it. And then so it becomes unnatural. The photo is much more washed out than a photo of a butterfly fish that's taken up close. So in general, they're much harder to photograph.
Need
you can go ahead.
Millimeter lens. Get up close and personal.
A fish eye.
Yes. So if I had a wider angle lens, that would solve the problem of getting close. But in a lot of places, those fish are fit. The parrotfish in general are hunted.
That's very good meat.
Yeah. So it gets hard to get close to them because there's so many spearfishermen spearing them. They are used to running away from humans. So they run away from a photographer the same way they run away from a spearfisherman.
Yeah, that's learned behavior.
Exactly.
Survival.
Imagine the like the outrage people would have if you went into a market or grocery store and you saw a bunch of speared parrots, and yet the parrot fish, it's somehow acceptable to eat them, even though they play such a valuable role. I've even seen these guys on ice at Harrods in England, and anytime I go to any island community, you know, see these guys laid out on the ice, but they do so much to keep the reef healthy.
Much more valuable alive than
on ice.
Yeah, on ice.
Yeah, absolutely, they are one of those. And catching them is trickier than other species because they don't eat, they're herbivores, basically. Some of them also eat coral, again, exception. most of them are herbivores, but some of them eat coral, but none of them eats shrimp or other fish. So you can't catch them with hook and line, with where you put a shrimp as a bait. They don't come with hook and line. So the only way to catch them is either by spearfishing, which again makes their behavior be so skittish, or by traps, which is a relatively destructive way of fishing because it indiscriminately catches a lot of fish of different sizes and so on.
Right. Yeah. And they can't, and if they get in there where the fisherman doesn't come back, then the trap just keeps trapping the fish.
Need the reef, but the reefs need the parrotfish. I mean, it just
how do they keep the reef healthy? I mean, what is their primary function on the reef to keep it in good shape?
It's the diet, basically. So they really like eating algae that is attached to that coral. And they also feed on the epiphytes that live on the algae. So they get a lot of protein from protozoa, from microorganisms that live within the turf algae. And then they kind of digest the algae itself. And they take big chunks out of that coral that's covered in these foods that they like, and they digest the food, and then they expel the pulverized coral, which we will get back to in a second.
but they still put nutrients back into the system.
Yeah.
So it's a don't know, it's a mutually beneficial relationship.
Absolutely. So just to summarize more or less how many species there are. So there's over 100 species in 10 genera. 53 of those species are in the genus Scarus. So that's the most diverse genus of all the parrotfish. They're tropical and subtropical. Sometimes they're found in really cold water. I was just in the, so before going to the Maldives, I was in the Galapagos. And even in the upwelling areas of the Galapagos, where the areas, the water is really cold, you still find parrotfish.
Wow.
They live in coral reefs, rocky reefs, seagrass, anything that has a kind of a structure or that has things that they like to eat. Most of the species are in the Indo-Pacific, and the name Scarus comes from the ancient Greek Scarus, that means parrotfish, so very, very actively.
Very direct.
Exactly, very exactly named. So I'm going to give a little bit of a taxonomic background here. This is not a parrotfish. So if you look at the mouth there, it's lacking the traditional beak of the parrotfish, but it kind of overall in shape and size, it looks like a parrotfish. It's a wrasse.
Yeah.
Up until about 20 years ago, wrasses and parrotfish were considered two different families. Scaridae were the parrotfish and Labridae were the wrasses. So when, again, we started using genetics to determine relationship between families of fish, we discovered that parrotfish were deeply nested within wrasses. So in reality, parrotfish are not their own family. They're part of wrasses. So now they're classified inside the wrasse family. They're their own subfamily. So they're still a group that's called parrotfish. It's not just a family anymore. It's now a subfamily of wrasses. So they're so closely related to wrasses that they're within the Labridae family. And the biggest difference is the beak. Wrasses, they can be caught with hook and line. They mostly eat invertebrates. They eat smaller fish. And parrotfish feed on that those algae that are covering dead coral mostly, or also rocks or in seagrass and things like that.
Do the parrotfish change sexes the way that wrasses do?
Yes, they do, cool. Just like wrasses do. So they are hermaphrodites. They start off as females. Most species, again, there are exceptions, but most species start off as female. And then as they grow, they get to a certain size, then they become males. And the dominant male, as long as it's that dominant male and that parent is alive, all of the other individuals are females. And then when the dominant male dies, the next biggest female turns into a male and then becomes the dominant male of that particular harem. But this is what this slide here shows you what differentiates a parrotfish is from other wrasses, which is the beak. And each beak, and you see on the left there, each species has a very specialized kind of beak, depending on what they eat, which coral they eat on, how hard the coral is. And speaking of hardness, the teeth of the parrotfish is one of the hardest substances known in bio-engineered substances known.
Wow.
There's a scale of hardness that is used for minerals from 0 to 10. So gold is about 2.5 in that hardness scale. Iron is about 4 in the hardness scale. Parrotfish teeth is 5.
Yeah.
So it's harder than iron. It's not as hard as titanium and other metals, but it's harder than iron. And it needs to be like that because they take chunks out of the coral. They bite algae that is really close to rocks. So if they break their teeth, they can't feed. So their teeth have to be very, very hard. And it's one of the hardest biogenic substances known to us.
I hear them underwater, like diving. You can hear them on
crunching. Absolutely, you can, yes.
But I've never heard of anyone being bitten by a parrotfish. We're not on their menu.
No, we are definitely not on their menu. Triggerfish bite us. Triggerfish are very territorial. So I was chased by a triggerfish this last trip to the Maldives because I got too close to their nest. When triggerfish are nesting, they will let you know they're nesting and they won't let you know.
They'll leave a mark. Very
exactly. Yeah. But parrotfish, they don't. Thank goodness they don't, because if they did, they would take a big chunk out of us.
Yeah.
They don't build nests the way the triggerfish do.
Exactly.
They're guarding their future when they come after them, when you get too close to their nursery. But it's different with parrotfish.
Yes, parrotfish and wrasses, they spawn in the water column, and immediately when the eggs that fertilize, they float away. So they don't. There's no parental care. All the larvae go out in the open ocean, and they stay in the open ocean for about a month. It's one of the most amazing things that there is about reef fish. And most reef fish are like this. They release sperm and eggs. The larvae stay out in the open for a month and hoping to find a coral reef when it's time for them to settle as babies on the coral reef. So sometimes they can travel hundreds to thousands of miles connecting different populations as larvae.
Until they get like endemic species around seamounts and things like that, right?
Right, yeah. Right. Yeah, to be very, very isolated to be endemic.
Yeah. What a way to start life.
Yeah.
Oh, look at that. There they are in action.
Exactly. So that's Ceroscarus ocellatus. It's a widely distributed species in the Indo-Pacific. And it's taking a chunk of, you see in the bottom there, the bottom just below the mouth of it, there's a live coral. And then this wider portion is dead coral that has been covered with turf algae and bacteria. And there's a whole substrate there. So they take a chunk out of that. And they have this very specialized pharyngeal jaw.
Wow.
So this is a view inside the mouth of the parrotfish. So they have two sets of jaws. They have that outside jaw, that's the beak, that's super hard, that takes the chunk out of the coral. And then when the coral goes in, it goes through this, it looks like a mill, these sets of teeth on the top of the mouth and the bottom of the mouth that grind the coral. And then they kind of make everything into a mush. And when it goes into the stomach, the parrotfish digests the algae and the bacteria and the epiphytes that go with that. And the rest of it, the sand, goes out as this.
I was hoping you'd have a photo of that.
Oh, there you go. Yes, absolutely. And this is one of the biggest ecosystem services they provide to the reef, is giving that back, that calcium carbonate, to the corals, that the corals need that to grow themselves, but also making this. This is an island in the Maldives, and depending on where you are in the world, but in general, in tropical islands where there's a lot of coral reef, up to 70% of the beach, if it's a white sand beach like that, can be composed of sand that has been through a parrotfish at some point. So basically, parrotfish poop. Yeah, exactly.
I've heard people say that, you know, like one big parrotfish can contribute like hundreds of pounds of sand every year.
Yes, depending on the species, up to 1,000 pounds of chance.
Yeah, 1,000 pounds. Yeah, perfect. You know, it's incredible.
Yeah, the really big ones. Yeah.
You want to save the beach, save the fish.
Exactly. Yeah. As you say, no blue, no green. We should also say no parrot fish, no
sand.
No sand. Parrot fish, no beach. Yeah.
It's really true. And all around the world, you know, I think that's the case. They just, and you know, what about the areas that have other than white sand beaches? Like, you know, Bermuda has the pink sand and Hawaii has some of the other different colored sand. Is that partly because of what the parrotfish have in their diet, or is that just a mixture of the minerals in the area too?
It's mostly, sometimes it's different things in the diet. Most of the times in Hawaii, for example, in the black sand beach, that would be volcanic sand. Mm-hmm. That gets eroded with the rain. So whenever you have a large landmass, usually there's erosion because of rain, because of wind, and then that sand comes down to the beach and it forms the beach, or it adds color to that white sand from the parrotfish. Mm-hmm. But when you have like an atoll with a very low laden island, that there's no other source of minerals, the only mineral that comes in is pulverized coral. It's a mix of parrotfish poop and just pulverized and coral that is broken up by organisms or by just the wave action.
Awesome.
Yeah.
That's one of the coolest things about these fish. Oh, look at the big lumpy heads.
So this is the largest parrotfish of all, Bobometapon muricatum. And it's the one that contributes, one of those fish can contribute over 1,000 pounds of sand per year. One fish.
Wow.
To the reef.
How old
now, again, going back to the whole hunting and sadness of the story, because they get so large, these fish get to 4 or 5 feet long.
Wow.
One fish can weigh almost 100 pounds, and they are good meat to eat. Then they're threatened. They're one of the few species of parrotfish that are critically endangered because they're spearfished in many, many different places throughout the Indo-Pacific where they occur.
How old might they be, Luis?
They easily get to 20, 30 years.
Yeah. Yeah, parrots and parrotfish live a long time.
Right.
So when you take one out, you really do leave a space. And it kind of looks like they're social too.
So this species, the bobo metapom is known to roam the reef in schools like that. Other species, they kind of live in loose aggregations. You see one here, one there, but the ones that are like really close together like this, as far as I remember, bobo metapom is only one of the few of them.
Hmm.
Yeah.
So sad to lose that, I don't know, that history, that way of the way of the fishes.
Yeah.
That if you only see one, he's probably pretty lonely.
I remember seeing, you know, when we did so much work in the Bahamas, and they used to have enormous schools of the midnight parrotfish.
Yeah. And the blue too.
Yeah, then the big blue ones, and they're just so cool to see, you know, 20 or 30 of them going by and
big group. Before the appetite for parrotfish began. You know, that's a relatively new habit. I mean, maybe in some places, parrotfish have always been consumed with people as long as people have been around. Parrotfish have been around a lot longer than humans. But nobody would think of eating a parrotfish because they don't taste good. I mean,
tasty standards.
Yeah.
They're definitely not as good as the other species, but it's the good old Daniel Pauly that came up with that. The fishing down the food chain. So usually the easiest fish to catch are those that you can catch with hook and line. So they're the carnivores, grouper, snapper, and they're the ones that taste better too. Jacks, they taste really good. Parrotfish, I don't particularly like it. It kind of have a sandy taste. And they can only be caught either by snorkeling and spearing, or you can catch them conceivably, some of the species in some of the places in the Caribbean, for example, you can catch them with spears from shore. And there are reports of Native Americans back in the, before colonization begun, of catching them from shore with spears from outside of the water, because those large schools of big blue parrotfish would come up so close to shore to feed that they would be able to spear them from the beach. Now we don't see that anymore because there's not enough parrotfish left. I think the only place in the Caribbean where you can see them, the largest ones in big numbers like that, is Bermuda.
Yeah.
And that's only because Bermuda, even though the whole island is not a marine protected area, the entire country of Bermuda banned fishing parrotfish.
That's smart. They really
are. Yes. So you can't fish parrotfish with any way. So you can't trap them. You can't catch them with spear. You can't sell them. You can't buy them. And that fully protects them. Even though Bermuda is not a marine protected area, it protects the parrotfish. So we see them a lot. I mean, I've seen in Bermuda, 3 feet long guacamaya, Scarus guacamaya, the big Caribbean species, with their tails flopping out of the water because they were feeding on the bottom, and they're so big that they're bigger than the depth where they are, and their tails would be like flopping out of the water like that. So when
I've
you see that
there too.
Yeah.
We were testing, doing some testing and training one of the bigger submersibles that we delivered to a client there, and the parrotfish were just beautiful. I mean, you could just see them. Well, like you say, right from the shore, any of the little seaside restaurants, you could see the parrotfish cruising along, and people just love to see them.
Right,
so beautiful.
Right.
Yeah, there's some people who say you can't protect the ocean. It doesn't work, but that's evidence that it does work. If you stop the killing and start the caring, it's amazing that recovery is possible.
They come back for sure. Yeah. And that should be the case for some ecosystem engineers, like a fish like this, a bobo metapon, that they shouldn't be caught at all. Because they take a long time to grow. They reproduce relatively slowly. Their populations are small to begin with, because a reef can't sustain 100 million of these giant parrotfish. There's only a small number of them there to begin with, everything in nature, it's not like humans that we just keep our numbers keep growing and growing. nature abide by the rules of nature. We are resource. If your fish is resource limited, it's not going to have a population that's bigger than what that reef can sustain. So in any given reef, to begin with, there's only going to be a few hundred bobometapum parrotfish. And if you catch them all, then that's it. There's no more viable population in that place. And they usually take a long, long time to come back. So species like this definitely shouldn't be touched anywhere.
Yeah. So I look at these creatures. Everyone has a face.
Mm-hmm.
We somehow don't think of fish the same way we think of other wildlife, but they are wild animals.
Yeah.
We should accord to them the same kind of respect that we do for birds and other wild animals.
Right.
We need them alive.
Yeah.
We need us to take care of them so we don't lose.
Yes. So another curiosity about these guys, if you look at the faces, the bumps, that white patch along their face, is because they use the head and the bump on the head to break the coral before they eat it. So they kind of head bump the coral.
Yeah, got it.
And then they eat the small pieces, and then that second set of jaws crushes it, and then they pull tons and tons of sand every year.
That's amazing.
On the reef and make beaches. So now let's get into a little bit more of their biology and something that you mentioned in the beginning, which is the sex change. So most species of both wrasses in general and parrotfish in specific here, they start off as females. They have an initial phase, which usually, but not always, the babies look exactly like the females. And then the males, when they become males, they're very different than the females, usually more colorful. And bigger than the females, which is the same for birds and a lot of other and lions and mammals and a lot of other animals of bears, that the males are fleshier. But also, again, there are exceptions, and we're going to get there. So this one is Scarus gobbon, and it's a very interesting species because it's one of the species of parrotfish that has the widest distribution in the world. So this species here, I took this picture in the Galapagos just about 2-3 weeks ago. And it occurs from the Galapagos, the Scarus gobbon, and the tropical Eastern Pacific in general, all the way to the Indian Ocean and West Africa. So this species can be found from Tanzania to Panama.
Wow.
It occurs in the entire Indian Ocean, the entire Pacific Ocean. Is the wider distribution of any parrotfish that we know of. Scarus gobbon. It's amazing.
Must have durable young.
Yeah,
they can drift
on those currents for a long time.
Right. Yeah, they can stay as a larva for a longer time than everybody else. And this is the male of the same species. So how different that is.
It is teeth.
the teeth is not being obvious, right? Yeah.
It's got that winning smile, you know.
Yes, they always look like they're smiling. I think there's a famous photo. I forgot the photographer that won. An underwater photography contest. They took a photo of the parrotfish like face on with the smile on their face. That's a beautiful photo. You can look for that on the internet to put in there.
It might be a David Dubilet picture. I think I've seen that.
Maybe.
One.
Yeah. So the sex change in itself is super interesting because it occurs in different stages. So as I said, usually there's a harem of a few females that are dominated by one or two bigger males. And when that male dies or is removed by any reason, the female, the most dominant female, almost immediately starts behaving like a male.
Hmm.
And then the behavior kind of triggers the other changes. So when it starts behaving like a male, the color starts changing to male. And then the last change is the gonads. Hmm. So it physiologically becomes a male.
So interesting.
Yeah.
It's fluidity in what we call sex.
Yes.
Yes, very much so. In parrotfish, as far as we know, they can only change one way. So from female to male. But there's other species of wrasses, like the cleaner wrasse, for example, that changes both ways.
Wow.
So they don't do harems. They are usually groups of equal numbers of male and female. And if there's, say, I don't know, three males and three females, and then a couple of females die, the males will change to female to kind of balance the gender or the sexes in the harem there.
Nice.
Parrotfishes, as far as we know, it's only a one-way change. But so as I said, everything is exception, right? So this is another exception here. The parrotfish, usually the males are prettier than the females. And this is one of the first species of parrotfish that was described. This is Parrotsoma cretense from the Mediterranean. So the Mediterranean is that sea that it's along Europe, and Europe is where taxonomy and science, modern Western science in general, started. So because taxonomy started in Europe, the European fishes were the first ones to be named. And this is one of the few parrotfishes that lives in the Mediterranean. So it was one of the first ones to be scientifically named. The type specimen was collected in Crete. So that's why it got the name Parrotsoma cretense from Crete. And this is the male, which is a very drab and kind of gray colored male. And this is the female.
Holy mackerel.
Oh. Of the same species. So it is like the opposite rule of every parrotfish that we know of. And we have no idea why. In general, we explain the differences in sexual dichromatism. That's what the term for when the coloration is different between male and female. So dye is two and chroma is color. So dichromatism means two or color are different colors. And a lot of birds have that, and a lot of fish have that. And in general, the males are more colorful because the females select them to be more colorful. So they like the males that are more colorful, that we call that sexual selection. And slowly the males become more colorful because they fight with each other to dominate the harem, to dominate the females. But in this particular case, I have no idea why, and I don't think anybody else does, why this species, the females, are much more colorful than the males.
How deep do these guys live?
They are, so this species and parrotfish in general are relatively shallow because they feed on mostly algae and coral, and algae and coral are only very shallow water, then they are very shallow water. Interestingly enough, I can go back to that, I guess. The Sparizoma, this guy here, Scarus gobbon, the one that's super widely distributed, it's also the species that has the widest depth distribution. So it goes deeper than every other species. I think it's mostly because it's more generalist in terms of feeding. So if it finds a crab and it's easy to catch it, we eat. It's more generalist than all of the other parrotfish. Hence, like the wider depth distribution and probably also the wider geographic distribution.
So, Luis,
yeah.
The previous guest on Dive In talked about vision underwater. And you wonder, what we see as color may not be what the parrotfish see. And the question is, do we know? And how could we know? And I wonder, so, wonder.
That's a great question. Yeah, and it's the addressing that question is still in its infancy. There's very few people working on that. There's some people working on the structure of the eyes of fish, just looking at how many cones and prisms and kind of biologically, physiologically looking at the eye and seeing trying to understand what color spectra they see. But also very importantly for water is that water is a filter of light, and light doesn't penetrate homogeneously into the water. So as shallow as 10, 20 feet, there's almost no red light underwater anymore. There's still a lot of light, but it's mostly blue light.
Right.
The light that penetrates the deeper in the water is blue. So we're seeing a redfish here. This picture I took at about 60 feet depth, and at 60 feet, there's no red light. The only reason why the fish look red in my photo is because I used strobes. So I added artificial light there. So that light that it's reflecting is not even in the environment. So in addition to what can they see is also what can they, biologically, what can they see based on their vision is also what they perceive by looking at that in an environment that has no red light.
That's why I was curious, because so many times we'll see the really deep fishes can have a lot of red.
Yes.
Really, they disappear.
Yeah, they kind of, it's almost camouflage.
Yeah. So that can definitely be camouflage.
And the issue of fluorescence that is visible to creatures that we can't see it without special arrangements.
Yeah.
Different kinds of light, but they can see it just naturally.
Right. Yes, absolutely. There's some wrasses that have red fluorescence. Mm-hmm. I'm not sure if fluorescence was detected in any parrotfish, but that's like how little we know about nature, I guess.
It's so much to do.
We have more unanswered than answered questions, and people often ask me, I mean, is there still anything to explore in the planet? I'm like, there's like a billion unanswered questions that you could pick one species and spend a lifetime of a career in one species of parrotfish, just understanding how they grow and what they eat and how much sand they poop. That paper, the number that we quoted about 1,000 pounds a year, that happens literally. It was a scientist snorkeling, following one of those parrotfish around and then quantifying how much poop he did, how much sand came out every time they pooped and how many times they pooped during the day. And that's how you came up with 1,000 pounds a year, because you could just literally follow them around collecting their poop and weighing it.
Well, you've got to be able to quantify it somehow. Otherwise, you won't begin to appreciate how valuable they really are.
Right.
How is the coral bleaching around the world impacting parrotfishes?
Certain species. So there's a lot of species that depend, that feed on live coral. Those are not doing great, because if the coral dies, they die. There's other species that are, they feed mostly on algae that are over dead coral. So for those species, it's probably even a better thing, that a good thing that there's bleaching, because when the coral dies, there's more dead coral. So there's going to be more surface for the algae to grow and there's more food for them. But I think in general, as a trend, worldwide parrotfishes are declining and their biggest problem is overfishing.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah.
It's us.
Yeah,
no matter
again.
How you look at it.
As usual.
Yeah.
But we're the cure as well as the cause.
Yeah.
Yes. Exactly what needs to be done. It's just we need to take action.
I was glad to see that, you know, like I read that Mexico had added 10 species of coral, of parrotfishes, to their protected species list back in 2018. It'd be really nice to see other countries start to do that.
Yeah.
Like Mexico, but just unilaterally protect them everywhere.
Right.
Like birds.
Oh man, look at this great one.
So this is arguably, I don't know. I mean, I have a hard time. Every time someone asks me what my favorite fish is, I always have a hard time trying to answer that. But I think this is my favorite parrotfish. This is Cetoscarus ocellatus. And remember when I said that most parrotfish, the babies look exactly like the females, and then the females turn into the male that's more colorful. This is one of those exceptions. So this is the female, which is beautiful in and of itself. That's the male, which is spectacular.
Wow.
And it gets really big too. It gets to about 20, 30 inches long. So it's a large species in the large side. I'd say on average, most parrotfishes have between 10 and 20 inches long. This one has 30 or 40. So it's a bigger species, but I think the juvenile, the baby of this species, is one of the most beautiful fishes on the reef, and that's it. Aww. Right there. And it's one of the most unusually colored butterfly fish there is in the world. I've never seen anything like that before. Every time I see one, I go out of my way to photograph it.
It's just gorgeous.
Yes, it's the most beautiful baby parrotfish there is.
That tiny little beak.
Yeah.
It's almost as if they're kind of, they almost look like they're mimicking some other small reef fish, like that would give them some hiding advantage or something.
Right.
Almost like a little clownfish.
Yeah. Yeah. And this one is about 2 inches long. So it's very small.
Adorable.
And then after they get bigger than about 4 inches, they start changing into that female color. And then if there is a dominant male in place, they'll stay with the female caller until whoever is next in line replaces the male.
You can't make this stuff up.
No, it's just mind-blowing. Yeah, this fish is just, every time I see one, I stop and photograph it.
Yeah, you just have to.
Just absolutely have to. And the color, like the white, is really unusual in parrotfish. We see a lot of browns, a lot of greens and blues. some red here and there, except for the one species that the female is completely red. But I don't think there's any other parrotfish that is white like that, this kind of solid white. It's just amazing to me.
It almost says like that when you talked about the butterfly fish, about that sort of the eye spot. This almost looks like that sort of an eye
this
spot.
This is definitely an eye spot. And the eye, what you see when it's an eye spot, the eye is hidden. So that orange band there on the head in the yeah. eye matching the orange kind of hides the real eye. And then the false eye on the dorsal fin acts as a distraction for the predator. So when the predator thinks that's the eye, it goes for it, and then it's not the head, and it disorients the predator just for long enough for the fish to escape.
Escape, little parrotfish.
Yeah.
Exactly.
run.
So you mentioned Mexico added quite a few species in 2018 to their endangered species list. This is a Brazilian species that was added to the Brazilian endangered species list a few years ago. It's the sister species to the Caribbean blue, the midnight parrotfish. So this Beautiful. One is Seagrass crispinosus from Brazil, and it's one of the most heavily fished species in Brazil because it lives in very, very shallow water. It's very easy to catch. It gets very large, and you know, people just catch it for food. There's one place that I went to in Brazil a couple of years ago called Abrolhos. It's one of the biggest, longest established marine reserves in Brazil. And I think it's the only place where we see still like healthy, large populations of this species.
Wow.
Maybe in due course, they can recover. There's some place that's safe. And that's part of the real importance of having areas where you just leave things alone.
Well, and the enforcement to make sure that that it is carried out. It's equally important
to protect it.
Yeah.
The biggest problem in Brazil is enforcement. There is a relatively large network of marine protected areas. And this particular species here is protected in the entire country, but it's still caught a lot. Yeah. And it's when you clean the fish and you sell just the fillet, it's a white fish fillet. You can mark it as anything, as snapper, as grouper. There are ways to test that. We can test it with DNA, but it's quite expensive to sequence the DNA of every fish fillet that comes to the market. We could do a subsample and then go after people that we know that do this routinely and we hold those companies accountable and stop their activities. But it's quite hard. And in a country like Brazil, where there's so many social problems, usually the environmental issues are kind of left to the last priority, the lowest possible priority.
It's an area where I think consumers can really make a difference because they can just, if they don't know, if they're not 100% sure of what they're purchasing, they can always opt not to buy it.
Right. Yeah. Absolutely. By the way, is another species where the baby, so this is the baby of this Seagrass crispinosus, is another species where the baby is quite different. So this one, the crispinosus, go back to that one, the female and the male looks almost the same. The female, this is, I can't even quite tell if it's a male or a female because it's like almost intermediate. When it's a very large specimen, it's almost always a male. When it's that size, which is about 2 foot long, and it's another species that grows a lot, then it's hard to tell if it's a male or female, but because their color is the same, male and female. And then we have the baby that looks very different from both male and
female. Just blue lips.
I know, right?
Little blue eyeshadow.
Yeah. And their food is the turf. So it's the algae that grows on top of the rock. And when you see them feeding, they kind of go sideways and kind of grab the food from the rock. So they use their very hard teeth to scrape the rock and grab the turf. And then everything that comes with the algae, that lives with the algae, goes in and they digest everything. And then again, they poop the pieces of coral that they break off with it.
Very cool.
Yeah. This is the most endangered species in the Caribbean. That's the Seagrass guacamaya. And guacamaya is the indigenous. Oh, third time is a charm. Indigenous name for parrot. So guacamaya is parrot in the indigenous languages and of Caribbean indigenous languages. And that, luckily enough for us, I mean, the name was not Latinized, so they kept the original name for that species, but it fits it perfectly because guacamaya and this parrot and nothing more fitting for a parrotfish species than a parrot name. It's another one that grows really large. It gets to 3 or 4 feet long sometimes, very heavy. Again, very sought after, very easy to catch and in big, big trouble. We have some indications that its population declined by over 90 or 95% in the past 100 years.
Wow, it's just so shocking. It's such a beautiful, it's just a living work of art. It's so beautiful.
Yeah, I can imagine.
There's reports. So you can kind of see how shallow it is. It's the top of the tail there is almost breaching the water. And there are reports of people in the 1920s, 1930s shooting them with rifles from shore, from the rocks, and then
cleaning them up. What's the joy of killing something that is doing you no harm? And
it's actually giving you a lot of benefit.
Yeah, they're doing. Yeah.
I guess at that point in time, they probably didn't understand how.
Yeah, but parrotfish historically have not been the favored fish to put on your table to eat.
That's true.
They don't have the same appeal, human taste.
Yeah.
I guess if they're easy to catch and you're hungry.
Yeah. In the large species case in particular, they're declining so much mostly because they're easy to catch and they're large and they have a lot of meat. It's like, it's not as nice as other fish. I wouldn't go out of my way to buy it for sure. It's a lot and they're relatively easy to catch. So that's the appeal.
Yeah, the large, slow, and tasty are the ones that always
exactly large, slow, and tasty.
Yeah. Ed Wilson's observation about the big wild animals that going back 10,000 years ago were perhaps in trouble because of climate change, but for sure humans as predators really did them in. I mean, plenty of evidence that our impact on the land of now, there's certainly evidence that especially since the 1950s, as our numbers increased from where we were at that time, about 3 billion, now we're 8 billion. And the access to the ocean and places that previously were protected because of their inaccessibility now are wide open. And the numbers, Luis, I think something on the order of half of the big wild animals in the sea since the 1950s are just gone. Mm-hmm. You know, they call it defaunation.
Yeah.
That means life has been so depleted. We see it with birds. We recognize the loss of wild animals on the land, but we're still kind of take for granted that what you see in restaurants and in supermarkets must be okay, otherwise they wouldn't be there, but that's just not true.
Yeah.
When you see sharks down by 90%, this beautiful animal down again in more than 90% gone, mm-hmm. not over thousands of years, but in decades.
Yeah.
In my lifetime.
Right. It's interesting. I was in the IUCN workshop that just points out flaws in policy, but I was in the IUCN workshop that evaluated the status of the species, and the criteria of the IUCN indicates that you can only classify something as critically endangered or one of the threat categories if they're currently declining or if the decline happened over the past 3 generations.
Wow.
This fish, we estimated their generation in 15 to 20 years, but the decline precedes that. Remember when I said that they were fished with rifles in Caribbean shores and things like that. So that's where the decline dates back to. So if we look at this, the past three generations, the populations are so small that there is no decline anymore. It's 5% of the original, but because there is no decline, the IUCN doesn't allow us to put it in any threat category. So they were basically the categorization was forcing us to list these species as least concern.
Oh.
Because it's not declining anymore. And because there's none left, basically. And we were saying, no, we can't do that. So we fought back so much with the rules and regulations that we ended up classifying it as data deficient, which like a bad compromise, I think. It should be critically endangered, but we couldn't go around the classification of the IUCN.
Wow, something wrong.
More rules to be broken.
Exactly, yeah.
No, let's do it.
Consider that in all of the history of parrotfish, there's nothing to prepare them for predation with rifles.
Or spears.
Or spears, right. Or nets, or hooks.
Or traps.
Yeah. Or traps, any of these things. We are so good at killing. We were genius at killing things. And the natural systems just have nothing in their strategies for survival that can evade our clever ways of just eliminating them.
Yeah.
Which is why we're right on the edge of the greatest, this extinction crisis.
Yeah.
With more than a million species that are likely to disappear by the end of this century, but only if we keep doing what we've been doing, which is just indiscriminate killing wildlife in the ocean as well as on the land. But we have a choice. That's the great news.
Yeah.
So I love celebrating the fact that now we know.
Yeah.
We can't choose.
Because really, isn't there...
I would not like to see this animal disappear just because we don't know or don't care.
Isn't their only sort of real defense system? Don't they actually sleep at night and make a mucus?
They do make a cocoon. I totally forgot to put that in the presentation. We should have done it. I mean, and it's partly because of the whole everything that's happening weather-wise in the Bay Area. So I got here yesterday from the Maldives. When I got home, my power was out. My laptop died. And But I should have put it there. It's super interesting. They do. When they sleep, they form a little cocoon of toxic mucus around them so that other fish don't, or sharks or moray eels that feed at night don't eat them when they're sleeping. It's an amazing
sleeping bag.
It's like a little sleeping bag.
It is exactly like a sleeping bag, yeah.
Think about like how long that sort of, self-protection took to evolve.
Yeah.
And then you're confronted with something like a gun or a spear. I mean, what do you... they just don't have a chance if we don't take better care of them.
Hang on, we're nimble enough here that I think we can. You can still see my screen there, right?
Yeah.
So I'm going to Google parrotfish cocoon, and I can show you.
Okay, and then we'll go to some questions because
There we go. See, that was easy.
That was easy.
Oh, wonderful.
So a lot of species produce this mucus cocoon here. That's just a bunch of mucus outside the fish, and it stops any predator from coming in and kind of eating it.
So cool.
Because it tastes bad. Sometimes it's not even toxic. It's just that the taste is so repulsive that they don't go through it to get to the parrotfish.
Or it might just be a texture thing. There's like,
whoa. Exactly. Yeah. And going back to the Caribbean, I think the Caribbean people underestimate what's happening in the Caribbean. So what's happening in the Great Barrier Reef now, which is what we hear about, all of the bleaching, the massive bleaching events. I still think the Great Barrier Reef today, even with the past, I think it was 3 or 4 massive bleaching events that hit the area there, I think the Great Barrier Reef today is better than what the Caribbean was 30 or 40 years ago.
Mm-hmm. It's encouraging.
That's the Caribbean 30 or 40 years ago. I think it was worse than what the Great Barrier Reef is today, because there's so much. Great Barrier Reef is much more remote. It's very far from shore. The Caribbean, all of the reefs are really close to shore. The islands have been inhabited for hundreds to thousands of years, some islands. So the reefs there have been exploited for a long, long time. And one of the first fish to go were the parrotfish, which are the one of the key ecosystem engineers, because they remove the algae. So this is a really delicate balance in the coral reef. There's always a fight for territory. It's the area of ocean that they can grow so small that organisms are always trying to outcompete each other to see who dominates. And the two most like competing ones are coral and algae. So if there's too much algae, they'll dominate the coral and kill the coral. If there's too much coral, if the conditions are too good for algae, they can dominate the coral. If the conditions are too good for the coral, they can dominate the algae. So what keeps the algae in balance in coral reefs are herbivores, are organisms that remove the algae. And parrotfish are one of the key ones in the Caribbean and in many other places of the world. So when we as humans started fishing them hundreds of years ago in the Caribbean, their populations declined a lot. But the Caribbean was still kept relatively healthy because they had a lot of black spine, long spine sea urchin.
Oh, yeah.
That also eats algae. But again, like human intervention, right? So we opened the Panama Canal in the early 1900s. A few decades after that, in the 1980s, there's a parasite that comes from the Pacific into the Caribbean and completely wipes out the sea urchins from the Caribbean. So in the 80s, from that point on, the coral populations in the Caribbean were completely decimated by algae because there was no parrotfish and no sea urchin because of the parasite, and not no parrotfish because of all of the overfishing.
Yeah,
they get a little help from surgeon fish.
They get a little help from surgeon fish. Surgeon fish are smaller and more selective on what they eat.
Yeah,
parrotfish are like the massive. Yeah. And bigger parrot mass. And yeah.
So
but I've seen in many places, I've seen surgeon fish being fished too, because the parrot fish are all gone, so they're fishing the surgeon fish.
God, that's could you? That's if
way,
could, yeah. I guess you could stop sharing your screen and then we'll go.
Okay.
To, so see you big. There we go.
Yeah.
Awesome. Okay. Sherry says, are you seeing more parrotfish in areas where the coral died and algae exploded in numbers after this past summer?
Not really. And that's mostly because parrotfish are keeping check, not by their resource, but by how much they're caught.
Yeah.
In most places, fishing is what keeps their number down. So even if there's an abundant source of food, which usually there is, even when coral reefs are healthy, parrotfish still find plenty of food in the reef. What keeps their numbers down is humans.
Yeah.
And it takes a while for them to grow.
It does. They're relatively slow growers. Yeah.
They don't grow like a chicken.
Yeah.
All right. Caroline asks, if I were to travel to the Indo-Pacific to go diving, where would you recommend that I go to see the most parrotfish?
Ooh, that's a good question. If I wanted to pick one spot, I would probably go to Raja Ampat, Indonesia. That is relatively well protected. The local populations there learned that the fish are worth more alive than they are dead. So they do protect them. They make a lot of money through the diving tourism. So in general, the reefs and the fish populations there are quite healthy. There's other places like that in the Indo-Pacific. Tubataha is a good example. So the atoll of Tubataha in the Philippines is also completely protected and like a haven for parrotfish. I think one of the best places to see the large bumphead parrotfish, the big Bobo metapon, is in Sipadan in Malaysia. It's known for having big schools of them roaming around. And again, they're super well protected there. Nobody comes close to them because it's a really popular dive site. So people know that they're worth more alive than they're dead, and they protect them with tooth and nail.
People ask me, where's the best place to go diving? And I say, almost anywhere 50 years ago.
Almost anywhere 50 years ago. That's absolutely the case. And it's what's sad, I think, for me, really, but most especially, I think, for you, is that it kind of even depresses me sometimes to see the decline in our own lifetimes.
Yeah.
It's amazing.
Gutting, you know.
Need a time machine.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot more education.
Yeah.
All right, we're going to squeak in one more question.
Okay.
What are the predators of parrotfish other than humans?
Sharks, large groupers. There's groupers that get really big and they can eat parrotfish, morays. So I would say the top predators on a reef. Yeah. The babies are eaten by everything. the parrotfish. The larger ones are slightly safer because they're bigger, but still sharks would go for them on a heartbeat.
Yeah, I kind of wonder about like where the lionfish have gotten a real toehold, if they're eating like the baby ones, making it even harder for them to recover.
They absolutely are, yes. We did a study here where we looked at stomach contents of lionfish, including lionfish that they've arrived to Brazil now. They used to be contained to the Caribbean, now they're in Brazil, and they're eating the endemic parrotfish there too. So
They'll eat anything that fits in their mouth.
yes, exactly.
All right. Well, we are at the top of the hour, and
Oh,
I hate to stop because
this is really
parrotfish are
fun.
so cool.
Oh, Luis is so cool.
Luis is a star. Yeah. We'll have
Thank
to come
you.
talk about other kinds of fishes that
Yeah, we
we
need
should
to maybe ask for
harass.
requests for
Yeah, we'll harass you about wrasses.
grasses. Angelfish is a good one too. Yeah.
All
All right.
angelfish are beautiful.
Yeah.
Okay, let's do it. Okay, there's more
More to
fun
come for
here.
sure.
Stay tuned.
Before we go today, Sylvia and I would like to say thank you to Luis, to our producer, the Ocean Elders, and to everyone that dives in with us from the community. They just show up and participate every time. We're really grateful. Water connects us all. And we will be back later this month. And until then, remember to take care of the ocean.
As if your life depends on it, because it
It
does.
does.
Absolutely.
Thank you, everyone. We'll see you next time.
Thank you.
Bye for now.